I always like when you speak of your my big toe theory and apply it to questions of philosophy such as Zeno's paradoxes. We haven't done that before. I understand that you can make those paradoxes, which is still a subject of discussion, a little clearer through your my big toe theory.
Sure. Zeno's paradox. Zeno was a, I think, Greek, is fair to say. I don't know exactly the time frame. Probably, 400, 500 BC? Something in that neighborhood, anyway. And he was a philosopher who had a couple of paradoxes that said you can't get from point A to point B. It's actually impossible to do that. And the way he did this is there's a couple of them. One of them is the hare and the tortoise, and there's some other ones, but they all evolve around the same sort of thing. And that is, if you assume that space and time are continuous, okay, if that's your going-in assumption, space and time are continuous. And today, most physicists would agree with that. Space and time are continuous. They don't believe that it's digital. Well, given that space and time is continuous, then what Zeno did is he said that there's a logical paradox, because you can never get from A to B. Why not? Well, if you go half the distance from A to B and stop there, then you go half the distance of what's left and you get to a certain point, and half the distance of what's left you get to a certain point, and you continually progress towards your point. But you could go and make those half a distance jumps each time, halfway to your goal, halfway to B each time, and you would never get there, you see? Because no matter how close you get, the next time you only get half the way there. So you can never get it. You can never actually get there. So his point was that, and he did this both in space and with time. It was a similar argument that he did in time that he did with space. So believing space and time to be continuous, logic will tell you that there are these paradoxes, that space can't really exist because you can't ever get from A to B, and that time doesn't exist and keep ticking forward either, because you can never get place, because you can only get closer and closer and closer. So even if you have an infinite number of jumps, still you have yet another distance which you can divide in half to get there, you see. So even though you have an infinite number of steps, you never arrive. So that's, he was saying, well, that's impossible. Well, that's, many philosophers have said, well, we know why that isn't true, and just calculus, can take a limit. You do have a finite answer in the limit. But then calculus achieves that by breaking the distances into little discrete pieces, little delta X's and delta Y's, or delta T's. So it basically looks at a discrete setup and then shows where do you get, what's the value of the function as the coordinate approaches infinity, the number of iterations approaches infinity. That's his, that's the way calculus deals with it. And it does give a finite answer. But it does it actually by making the space and time into little delta T's, delta X's, or delta Y's. Now, the reason that you have this problem then is the faulty assumption that space and time are continuous. So given that that's true, that they're continuous, then there's a logical problem, you see. There's a lot of things that we do here in space and time that are impossible, logically, to achieve. So the obvious solution to those, when you read Zeno's paradoxes, and there's like six or seven of them, you immediately see that given that reality, that this universe is not created out of continuous space and time, that everything is digital. Time jumps forward in little chunks of delta T. Space degenerates into granularity, like pixels on your screen. at small enough distances. Okay, so everything is really digital. Why is that? Because it's generated in a computer. It's generated in a digital computer. And you jump, the time jumps from one delta t to the next delta t. It doesn't slide continuously from one to the other. Now it's time t, and later it's time t plus delta t. There was nothing in between. Time jumps in little hops like that. It's digital. Same with space. You're here in this part of space if you're down at the pixel level, and next, if you're moving, let's say, along the x-axis, you can only go from this pixel on the x-axis to the next pixel on the x-axis. You can't land anywhere in the middle. You go from this pixel to the next pixel to the next pixel. What's in between isn't defined, doesn't exist. There's nothing in between. There is no time between t and t plus delta t. There is no space between this pixel and the next pixel, because space is defined as these pixels, you see. So now it's trivial. You're going to look at all these things. Well, you keep dividing the distance in half, you eventually get down to one pixel, you see. And you say, well, I'm going to divide the distance between this pixel and the next pixel by half. Well, there is no distance, you see. To move at all, you have to go to the next pixel. So you can always get from A to B, because it's just a matter of a number of pixels will take you there, and eventually that last hop hops you into that first pixel of B. And that solves all these problems immediately, just realizing that. So the neat thing about it is that, again, an assumption of a digital virtual reality solves these logic problems that are still being argued today. Because today people still think space and time are continuous, and they're still fussing about these ancient problems of logic, because they really are. Zeno was no dummy. These are real logical problems. The logic, if you start with an invalid premise, like space is continuous and time is continuous, you end up with an invalid result, which you can't get from A to B. You see, you find problems that are logical problems based on an incorrect assumption. You correct the assumption and say that space and time are digital and discrete, then Zeno's problems all just melt away. There is no problem. You can't just keep dividing things by half. You get to a point where you're down to the single pixels, and there is nothing defined in between. So anyway, it's another place where you take an incorrect assumption that creates logical problems, logical paradoxes. And you look at the digital virtual reality and you say, oh, all those paradoxes just disappear. They're not there anymore. So all of those Zeno paradoxes go away. And there's another Zeno paradox, at least it was called Zeno paradox, that has to do with quantum mechanics. And what they found out, this was an experiment in quantum mechanics, and the experiment was done before the theory tried to figure out, how to explain it. That's why it was called a paradox. It seemed impossible. They had a quantum mechanical system, and maybe we'll just call it an atom. That's an easy thing to do. We'll call it an atom, and this atom, let's say, can be in state A or state B. If it's in state A, it'll decay to state B, and I'm making up all these numbers just to present the idea. Let's say that if it's in state A, then within a minute, it has a 50% chance of decaying to state B within 1 minute. Okay, so within a minute and 10 seconds, then it would have maybe a 60% chance of decaying, or a minute and 30 seconds would maybe be an 80% chance of having decayed from A to B. So there's just this quantum mechanical state, this atom that will decay with time. Maybe it's just a radioactive atom of some sort. Okay, well, what they found out is that they have this atom and they put it in state A, okay? And if they just let it alone, 50-50 chance that by 1 minute it's in state B, it's decayed, and then it stays in B. But if they set the state up in A, and then, let's say, in 30 seconds, they go in to check it and measure the state. So 30 seconds later, they go, yep, still in A. Then 30 seconds later, they measure it and go, yep, still in A. 30 seconds later, they go, yep, still in A. They can do that for as long as they wish, and it never goes to state B. The act of measuring that it's in state A, you see, keeps it from going to state B. And they could measure it, say, every 10 seconds in state A, and the probability that it would decay in 10 seconds is maybe, you know, 1 in 1,000 or something. It doesn't decay that fast, very low probability. So every 1 in 1,000, they might actually get a B. But mostly, if they keep measuring it very, you know, let's say every 10 seconds or so, it never gets a chance to go to state B before they measure it. And that was a big paradox, because why should that be so? Why should just the act of measuring it make it decay differently? We're not doing anything to it. It's still the same radioactive element that goes from A to B, and it does it, you know, with a 50-50 chance in 1 minute. It's still the case. So why does measuring it change the way the atom works? You know, didn't make any sense. So that was why they called it a paradox. Well, if you understand how reality really works and that it is a probabilistic system, what happens is every time you take the measurement and say it's in state A, well, that's because you've put it in state A, so when you reach up in that probability distribution, it's just a spike over A. It can't be anything but A, so it's A. Once you've seen that it's A, now you let go of it. Now there's uncertainty. It could change. Okay. So before it gets to the halfway mark, the minute where it has a 50-50 chance, you go in and measure it again. Well, what you've done now, you've gone into that probability distribution. At that time, the probability distribution is, say after just 30 seconds, it may be 80% that it's in A and 20% that it's in B. Well, what do you get when you draw out of that kind of distribution? Well, most of the time, you know, 8 out of 10 times, you're going to get A again, because that's the way the distribution is. So every time you go in, you look at it, you find it in A, because it's not yet probable that it's in not A. That starts it over again. Then when you look at it, you give it time. Now there's uncertainty. The probabilities start to change and start to shift with time. But every time you go in and measure it, you reset the clock, because now you've specified it as being in A. And we know that it only starts to change when you're not looking at it. You see, as long as you're looking at it in A, it's just going to sit there and stay in A. So if you measure, it never does decay. It just sits there and doesn't decay, which is not natural, you see, because these elements decay, and they shouldn't be not decaying just because you're looking at them. But that's the way the world works. You know, double slit experiment works the same way, you see. Mm-hmm. So the point is, it's only when you don't look then that probability starts to change according to the rule set for that element. But every time you hit it, you force it to draw from that probability distribution, which then resets the problem back to A again. And then you let it go. While you're letting it go, the probability is starting to shift. Now, if you wait for 30 seconds to go by, now you gotta, or what did I say, a minute goes by, whatever I said. If you let it go till it's a 50-50 chance that it could decay, you reach up into that distribution then, you have a 50-50 chance of getting an A or a B. You let it go for 2 minutes, and now you got a 90% chance of getting a B, you see? So while you're letting it go, the rule set probability is changing that distribution from all A to almost all B. That distribution is just changing. And when you go up and sample that, when you take a measurement, you're sampling that probability distribution. And when you take a random sample out of that probability distribution, then the system will render to you what that sample says that reality is like at that time. So that's exactly the same way we described, remember the tree in the woods? It's exactly the way we described, you know, the double slit experiment. That's just the way reality works. So now here's another example of a virtual reality, a probabilistic virtual reality, giving you a very easy answer to why it's like that.
What is keeping scientists from coming to the conclusion that the answer must be this reality is a virtual reality?
Well, you know, a lot of them are come into that. Matter of fact, I'd almost say, you know, I've been surprised lately at how many scientists, they don't say it out loud much, but more and more of them are even doing that. But the more scientists you talk to these days, they'll tell you, well, you know, reality does seem to be just information. That's what they'll say. Well, that's almost saying the same thing as a virtual. That's what virtual reality is. That's, you know, that's really the definition of a virtual reality, right? It's a reality created from information. That's what World of Warcraft is. It's what The Sims are. It's reality created from information in a server that hosts The Sims. That's virtual reality. But most scientists now should, well, when I say most, lots of scientists now have, they don't like it, but they've kind of had their nose rubbed in it so long that, like you say, it's very hard for them to say anything else other than reality is information. But they get to that point and they don't know what to do next with, you know, they don't know what the next step is. They say, all right, it looks like reality is just information. Let's change the subject. You know, let's talk about something else. But they don't know where to go with that.
What would be the next step for them?
Well, the next step would be to see that information is part of a structure. And that structure is what defines a virtual reality. And then, you know, we go with Fredkin, right? Then that virtual reality says, well, you know, where's the computer? And then, you know, the next step after that is consciousness is the computer. So it all follows along, and by the time you get to consciousness's computer, now you have 1 foot in metaphysics and 1 foot in science, and they all just meld together.
And that is exactly what your mind
does. That's exactly what we've done, right. So now you have metaphysics and science all become one thing with one understanding. So that's kind of where they go, but they don't want to do that. As soon as they say it's a virtual reality, somebody says, where's it being computed? And then it starts to get messy from there, and science doesn't want to go to those kinds of places yet.
Fredkin says other.
Fredkin says other. It's just another.
There's no reason why other isn't acceptable if they don't want to go further than that.
I think that makes them feel very insecure to say that reality starts from a place called other. They don't like that at all. It sounds too metaphysical. Well, so mostly they turn and run the other direction. But many scientists now are saying that reality is information. That's almost become acceptable. See, and that's really the first big step.
That's good.
Second big step is saying that it's, you know, it's a virtual reality. It's computed. Fredkin got there, and a lot more people are getting there as well. But that's the next big step, which hasn't happened yet. And then the third big step is to realize that consciousness is the computer. And that's the third big step. And once we get to that, then, like I say, then science and metaphysics have joined. When consciousness is the computer, then metaphysics and science have become one understanding. They're just looking at the world from different ends of the same thing.
This is your theory from your experience as a physicist and as an explorer of the larger consciousness system. This is the 10th anniversary of your publication of your book, of My Big Toe.
Yeah, it was published in 2003 in February, and now we're past February 2013. So
it's slightly past.
This is a decade that My Big Toe has been out there, but, you know, the first bunch of years it just kind of sat by itself and was very lonely because I didn't do any advertising. It just has to be viral. So it just had to sit until enough people stumbled on it by accident that it became better known. But it's doing all right now.
I think it is getting there. And thank you again, Tom, for this.
You're very welcome.